All right, what we're going to do in this tutorial is we're going to practice solving quadratic equations by using a process called completing the square. Now, normally with quadratic equations, I like to first see if I can solve by factoring, but I can see right away that this is an equation that we cannot use factoring to solve. Because our last term here, which is 7, has the factors of 1 and 7, and if you cannot take those factors and combine them in any way to make your middle term, that is an indication that you cannot use factoring to solve the problem. So you have to use a different method, such as using the quadratic formula or by completing the square. And that's what we're going to do in this tutorial. So the first thing that we have to do is we always have to make sure that our a value is equal to 1. Now, just as a reminder, the standard form of any quadratic equation is ax to the second power plus bx plus c. And if you take a look in front of your x squared term, the a term will be right to the left of that. That is the coefficient of x squared. And as you can see, there's no number in front of this x to the second power, which means our coefficient is 1. So that is a requirement that must be true before completing the square. This a term must be equal to 1. So we don't have to change it with this equation. All right, once you have verified that your a term is equal to 1, what we do is we make sure that this equation is set to 0. Now, the reason that this must be set to 0 is because we must remember that with any quadratic equation, really what we're doing is we are solving for the roots of that quadratic. And the roots of a quadratic really just means where does the parabola that would be formed by that equation intersect the x-axis? And a lot of parabolas intersect the x-axis in two spots. That's why we frequently get two answers when solving quadratic equations. And if you notice, wherever the parabola crosses the x-axis, the y value will be equal to 0. Now, a lot of times with any textbook or homework, your equation will automatically be set equal to 0. But if it's not, just start by setting it equal to 0. Okay, so now that we have our a value equal to 1 and this equation is set to 0, the next thing that we do is we take our c value and we move it all the way to the right-hand side of the equation. So we take the opposite of minus 7, which is plus 7, so we can move it over to the right-hand side. And now we rewrite our equation as x squared plus 4x is equal to 7. All right, the next step is really at the heart of what completing the square really is. So what we do next is we take our b value. In this case, our b value is 4. Your b value will always be the value right in front of your x. And you always take your b value and you divide it by 2 and you take that result and you square it. So the b value in this case is 4. So we take 4 and we divide it by 2 and then we square that value. And 4 divided by 2 is 2, and 2 squared is equal to 4. Now, once you get that result, what you do is you write it at the end of this side of your equation. So notice that I had a blank area that I left right here, and that's because I have to write the result of b divided by 2 to the second power in this space right here. However, you can't just go sticking something into one side of your equation. To make sure that your equation stays true to form, you have to balance it out by writing the same thing on the other side of your equation. So after dividing b by 2 and squaring, whatever result you get, in this case positive 4, after writing it on the left, you must also write it on the right-hand side. Now, the reason we take b and divide by 2 and square it and then write the result here at the end is because it creates a trinomial called a perfect squared trinomial. All that really means is you can take a binomial and multiply it by itself to get this result right here, which makes it very easy for us to solve. And you're going to see this illustrated in the next step that we're going to do. So once you have taken b and divided by 2 and squared it and have written it on the left-hand side and on the right-hand side, you're going to factor this trinomial out, and you're going to simplify the right-hand side of your equation. So let's go ahead and do that. So on the right-hand side, we have positive 11. And on the left-hand side, just start by writing parentheses. And the first position is always going to be an x. And because we have a positive right here, we're going to write a plus sign. And here's what we do next. And this will work every time. Just take your b term, whatever that is, in this case it's 4, and cut it in half. And half of 4 is 2. And that is what you write in this position right here. And that will automatically create the binomial that when you square it or multiply it by itself, will create this trinomial right here. And now we have an equation that will allow us to solve for x. All right, so here's the next step that we have to do. Because this entire quantity right here is raised to the second power, we want to get rid of this exponent here. And to get rid of something to the second power, we do the inverse of that, which is to take the square root of that quantity. A square root and something to the second power will cancel each other out. And what we do on the left-hand side, of course, we do on the right-hand side. So what we're going to do is we're going to rewrite this line right here as x plus 2 equals, and because we put a square root symbol on the other side, we have to remember that the square root of something always has two results, a positive result and a negative result. So x plus 2 is equal to plus or minus the square root of 11. This is a very important step, so please don't forget this. A lot of students forget to do that. So whenever you're completing the square, this quantity on the right-hand side will always say plus or minus. All right, now what we're going to do is we're going to isolate this x variable by moving this positive 2 over on the right-hand side of our equation. So what we're going to do is we're going to subtract 2 from this side, and we're going to subtract 2 on this side. So we are going to rewrite this as x equals negative 2 plus or minus the square root of 11. And the square root of 11 is already in simplest radical form, so there are no perfect squares that I can pull out of this, so we can leave our answer in this form. Now, if you wanted to, you can use a calculator to get some sort of decimal answer so you can see what those x values are, but it is okay to leave it in this form right here. Now, sometimes people will write both answers out. One answer would be negative 2 plus the square root of 11, and the other answer would be negative 2 minus the square root of 11. Because remember, we had plus or minus the square root of 11, which indicates that we have two possible answers, because this equation would create a parabola that would intersect the x-axis in two spots. And because this value here, the a value, is positive, we know that we have some sort of parabola that is going to open upwards and would intersect the x-axis in two spots. And these values here are the locations of those two spots on the x-axis. All right, let's go ahead and try another example. All right, so the first thing we have to remember is to check to make sure that our a value is equal to 1, which it is in this case, and then we take our equation and we set that equal to 0. All right, the next thing we have to do is take our c value, and we have to move it over on the right-hand part of our equation. So let's take negative 18 and write its inverse on the left, and then take that same value and write that on the right-hand side. So now we can rewrite our equation as x to the second power minus 3x is equal to 18. And remember, I always like to leave a little space here because we're going to end up writing something in that space right here. All right, now the next thing that we do is we take our b value. Now, notice that in this case, we have a minus in front of the b value, so we have to treat this 3 as a negative 3. So we take that value and we divide it by 2, and then we take that value and we end up squaring it. So basically we have negative 3 halves being multiplied by negative 3 halves. And remember, a negative times a negative results in a positive. So in this case, we end up getting positive 9 fourths. So in this blank space right here, we're going to write plus 9 fourths. And what you write on the left-hand side, you write on the right-hand side. All right, what we have now on the left-hand side here is a perfect square trinomial, which means when we factor this trinomial, we're going to end up getting a binomial that we can just multiply by itself to make this trinomial. So the next thing that we want to do is just write a set of parentheses. So we're going to go ahead and do that. And we know that it's going to be some binomial to the second power. And notice that our middle term here is negative, so I'm just going to end up writing a minus right away. And what we have to do in this position right here is just write an x, because we know that x times x is going to be x to the second power. Now, whatever we write in this position right here, that number times itself is going to result in 9/4. Now, in order to figure out what this is, all you have to do every single time, like we did in the first step, is take your b value and you have to divide it by 2. And 3 divided by 2 results in 3/2. We're just going to leave it as an improper fraction. So x minus 3/2 to the second power is the same thing as this trinomial right here. All right, what we have to do next is simplify everything on the right-hand side of our equation. Now, 18 is a whole number, and we're adding that to an improper fraction. So we're going to write 18 as a fraction, which would be 18 over 1. But we have to make sure that these denominators are common denominators, and the lowest common denominator of 1 and 4 would be 4. So we're going to change this denominator of 1 into a 4, and because we made that 4 times bigger, we have to multiply 18 times 4, which is 72, and this is already a 4, so we can just bring down 9/4. All right, what we're going to do next is go off to the side here, and we're just going to drop this down right here on the left-hand side. X minus 3/2 to the second power is equal to, and now we can just add 72/4 to 9/4, which would result in 81/4. All right, so after you have come up with the binomial that you are squaring on the left, and you have simplified everything on the right, the next step is to take the square root of everything on the left, and take the square root of everything on the right-hand side. And on the left-hand side, remember, this exponent here of 2 and the square root symbol will cancel each other out, leaving us with x minus 3/2 on the left. But over on the right, we're going to have plus or minus the square root of 81 over 4. Now, in this situation, we should notice that the numerator of 81 and the denominator of 4 are perfect squares. So that means we're not going to have any radical symbol remaining whatsoever. So here's what we're going to do next. Because we have minus 3/2 over here, we're going to add 3/2 on the left, and we are going to add 3/2 on the right. All right, so what we're going to do is go off to the side here. Let me make a little bit of space by erasing this right here and this right here, and this cancels out here, leaving us with just x on the left. And on the right hand side, we have positive 3/2, so we're going to write that first. And the square root of 81 is equal to 9, and the square root of 4 is equal to 2. So the square root of 81 over 4 is equal to 9/2. But remember, that's going to be plus or minus 9/2. So we write 3/2 plus or minus 9/2. All right, so now what we have to do is solve two different problems here. So let's start with 3/2 plus 9/2. And the second problem that we have to solve is 3/2 minus 9/2. Well, 3/2 and 9/2 would result in 12/2. And 12 over 2 is equal to 6, which is our first solution. And over here we have 3/2 minus 9/2, which would result in negative 6/2. And negative 6 over 2 would result in negative 3. So our first solution for this quadratic is positive 6, and our second solution is negative 3. So we have a parabola that would intersect the x-axis at positive 6 and at negative 3. And because our a value is positive, it would be a parabola that would open upwards. All right, let's go ahead and do another example. All right, so the first thing that we have to do is check to see if our a value is equal to 1, which it is not in this case. It is equal to positive 3. In this case, what we do is we have to turn it into positive 1 by taking that coefficient and dividing it by itself. However, we must divide that same number into your other terms as well. So we have to take 4 and divide that by 3, and we have to take negative 15 and divide that by 3 as well. So let's go ahead and rewrite this equation. So these 3's cancel out, leaving us with positive 1. So we have x squared for the first term. And for the second term, we have an improper fraction. So we're just going to keep it that way. We're going to write 4/3 x. And now we have 15 divided by 3, which is 5. So we write minus 5 for the c term. And now let's just set this equal to 0. All right, next we're going to take our c term and we're going to move it over on the right-hand side. So we write plus 5 on the left and we write plus 5 on the right. So on the right-hand side, that results in positive 5. And on the left-hand side, we have x squared plus 4/3 x. And we leave a blank here so we can make a perfect square trinomial. All right, now we want to take our b term and we have to cut that in half. However, we have a fraction and it looks kind of weird to take that fraction and put it over 2. So whenever I get something like this, here's what I like to do. I just like to take this value here and multiply by 1/2, because multiplying something by 1/2 is the same thing as dividing by 2. So 4/3 times 1/2 would result in 4/6, which can be simplified to 2/3. But don't forget, we have to take this value and we have to square it. So we have to multiply 2/3 by 2/3, which would result in 4/9. And this is positive 4/9. So we're going to go ahead in this space right here and write plus 4/9. And what we do on the left-hand side of our equation, once again, we do on the right-hand side. So we write plus 4/9 on the right-hand side as well. All right, now we're just going to write a binomial that when squared would result in this trinomial right here. The first position is always x, and the second position is going to be half of what the b term is. Luckily for us, we already figured out what half of our b term is. That is equal to 2/3. So right here in this position, we're just going to write plus 2/3. And remember, this has to be squared to result in this trinomial right here. And on the right-hand side, we have 5 plus 4/9. So basically, we have a whole number plus a fraction, and 5 and 4/9 is equivalent to 5 4/9. And we can rewrite this as an improper fraction. 9 times 5 is 45, plus 4 is 49. So that is equivalent to 49/9. All right, the next thing that we have to do is we have to take the square root of the left and the square root of the right. So this cancels out with the radical symbol on the left, leaving us with x plus 2/3. And on the right, don't forget, we have to write plus or minus that result. Now, if you notice, 49 and 9 are both perfect squares. So we can take the square root of 49, which is 7, and we can take the square root of 9, which is 3. Now what we have to do is we have to take this positive 2/3 and move it over on the right-hand side. So we're going to write the inverse of positive 2/3, which is negative 2/3. And we're going to do the same thing on this side right here. So now what we can do is cancel these out on the left, leaving us with just x. And I always like to take what I sent over on the right-hand side and write that first. And then I'm going to take our plus or minus term and write that second. So we have negative 2/3 plus or minus 7/3. So basically, we have two problems to solve here. So let's go ahead and solve each one of those problems. So the first problem we're going to break this up into will be negative 2/3. Let's start with our plus symbol here, plus 7/3. And the other problem we have to solve is negative 2/3 minus 7/3. Now, negative 2 and positive 7 results in positive 5. So when combining these two fractions together, that would result in positive 5/3. And for this problem, we have two negatives here. Negative 2/3 and negative 7/3 result in negative 9/3. Now, 5/3 we could leave improper, or we can express it as a mixed number. Expressed as a mixed number, this would be positive 1 2/3. And when simplifying this right here, negative 9 divided by 3 is negative 3. So these are the two solutions of our quadratic. All right, so we just solved three different quadratic equations by completing the square. So I want to say thanks for watching this video, and please don't forget to subscribe to my channel so you can become notified as new tutorials become available.